Well, come on, church. From wherever you are today, let's put our hands together and praise Him. Here we go. Take is from you, hope is running through my veins, filling up my heart with joy unending. Love is resurrecting me. Your love is light to me, it's written.
Hope, He is our life, He is peace, He is goodness. I can't think of a more significant time than right now. We need that reminder. No matter where you are, what you are facing, or what you are feeling, He will never let you go. Our God is always faithful.
Oh, my soul, be still. When my heart is fragile, hold fast to the truth, there is hope still in this storm. Help my eyes to see, though my faith is shaken, teach me to believe every word you say is true. You are making all things new. You remind me that you won't let go of me. No, you won't let go of me. Through every high and low, Jesus, you're constant through it all. Firm foundation, so I'm holding on. glory of creation. Everything is from your hand, reaching down out of the heavens, all to sculpt the heart, man. Not in gold and not in silver, nothing precious or refined. Across the universal wonder, you made dust your grand design. Oh, praise the Lord, the Lord Most High, Word of God, the breath of life, Maker of this heart of mine. You make dust your grand design. Yeah. Stepping down into the ruins, Word of God becomes shackles of this earth. From the dust I was created, and to the dust I will return.
Come on.
For a glorious resurrection, I'm restored and raised to life. Recreated in your presence, you made dust your grand design. You make dust your grand design. Oh, praise the Lord, the Lord Most High, Word of God, the breath of life, Maker of this heart of mine. You make dust your grand. Oh, you better sing.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Open Bible Church San Jose Online. We are so glad you are joining us. Right now, I'd just like for you to take a moment just to check in with us. If you would take your phones out and text to this number, 408-547-4911, 408-547-4911. And if you've never texted to that number that you are interested in connecting with us, then if you would just text the word connect and then follow the prompts, get you signed up. We'd love to hear from you. We'd love to stay in touch with you. If you have texted to that number before, just your first name and here, just to let us know that you are online, that you are watching this service with us today. Today is a very special day. Today is a Memorial Day. 1 year ago today, we started our online presence with the church services due to COVID. And so we have been going strong. We have been gathering every Sunday online. And we have been so thankful for those of you that have been a part of our service and our outreach. We appreciate your consistency, your faithfulness over this time. We appreciate your giving online, and we just appreciate so much that you have given us encouragement and hope. And as we strive to meet the needs of our changing community, because we have no longer been doing church as we normally do it, but we have been going online. We have been gathering outdoors pretty consistently since the month of May, and we are preparing sometime soon to be gathering indoors, hopefully in the next few months, if that. But we will keep you apprised of that. Another thing is we are 4 Sundays away, or 3 weeks away, from Easter service, our Easter celebration. And we're excited because we have a plan over these next 3 weeks to help you stay engaged during this Easter season. And it is called 21 Days of Hope. And we invite you to join us and be a part of this engagement, as we just want to be able to provide something for you to be reflective on and responsive to over the course of these next 3 weeks as we head into the Easter season. If you would just take a moment, and if you would like to be involved in this 21 Days of Hope, would you just text the word HOPE to that same number, 408-547-4911. And when you text the word HOPE, you will then begin receiving emails and texts every day for the next 20 days. And those texts will be texts of encouragement. They will be texts of engagement, how you can be engaged in a more physical way or a more spiritual way as we prepare for the Easter season. So we invite you to join us in this journey over these next 21 days. And to do so, if you would just take a moment and text the word HOPE, we would love to engage with you, and we would love for you to support these next 21 days as we strive to make this Easter the best Easter ever. So text the word HOPE to 408-547-4911. As I begin our message this morning, I invite you to celebrate the remodel of a home. And that home is your life, and it's my life. We've been talking the last few weeks about fixer-uppers and how God is in the remodeling business, and how God wants to come in and fix up our homes, our lives. Last week we talked about how Christ stands at the door and he knocks. And the only way he's going to come in is if we invite him in. We talked about the living room last week, and we talked about the living room representing the room of life. Well, this morning I want to focus on a very strategic, important room of the house, and that is the dining room. And when God comes into the dining room, he wants to remodel every aspect of the room itself to everything that is being served within that room. So many times when you walk into a home, you will see that there is a certain combination of the living room, the dining room, so on and so forth, in the kitchen. When you look at the dining room, there's more a modern approach to its setup into an open concept. No longer are they encouraging a separate kitchen and then a separate dining room, but you come in, and I love the remodel shows, and they'll come in and they'll demo a wall, and what they will do is they will open up both rooms, the kitchen and the dining room, to make it one room. And the idea of that open concept is to bring an inclusion into what's going on in the kitchen as well as what's going on in the dining room. I don't know about you, but sometimes if you have people in the kitchen and people in the dining room, they're separate from engaging together and knowing what's going on with the separate groups. And so what God has designed in our lives is to create an open concept of the dining room and the kitchen area. When you walk into my house, as you come into the front door and you walk into the entryway, we have a bathroom to the right, in fact, the only bathroom of the house. And then you walk into an open area. And that room not only encompasses the kitchen and the dining room, but also the living room as well. So it's one big old huge room. And it is great because if you have people in the living room or in the kitchen, in the dining room or the dining area, then they all can engage together. I really love that approach. But when you're looking at a dining room, kitchen, open concept, you're looking at a room that God has designed to be basically the center of activity of the house. The center of the dining room is the table. One of the more important aspects of that is that this becomes a very important centerpiece of the furniture of the home. And the center of the dining room table is family. And when you think of the dining room, you think of the family that gathers. One of the favorite questions that comes out of the dining room from our family is, "Hey mom, what's for dinner? What are we going to eat? What are we going to have?" And you know, as a kid, I always waited in anticipation for what my mom was preparing, because it either made or broke my appetite, so to speak, because if what she was serving was something I really wanted, it made me look forward to dinner. But if what she was serving really wasn't one of my favorites, then, oh man, I wasn't as excited about gathering at the dining room table. But one of the things about the dining room in my family growing up is that the dining room was a place of preparation. My mom was busy in the kitchen, and our kitchen was a little bit separated from the dining room. We didn't have an open concept back then, but the idea of engagement was still the same. We had responsibilities, and every one of us as kids, I had five siblings growing up, so each of us had a responsibility around the dinner table. And one day out of the week, we were responsible for setting up the table. So we would have to set out all the plates, all the silverware. We would have to help mom get the food from the kitchen onto the table. And it was all about the preparation, and it was all about getting the food ready for the family. So when we grew up, this was a centerpiece of our family. You know, I think the more our culture has changed, this one area has changed drastically, where we don't have family time around the table as much anymore. I know we're guilty of that. I don't know about you. Some families, they may reserve one day out of the week or a day out of the month to get family together where everybody sits at the table, everybody engages together. With today's schedules and my family being, as my boys are getting older, they're more on the run, their schedules have changed. And so we don't get that time around the table that we normally would like, especially from mom's side and my side. We enjoy getting the family together around the table. And as a kid growing up, that was a main staple of our family time. Every night, it was every night at dinner time, everybody gathered around the table. And so there was something to be said when a family is able to gather. Everyone is on the same page. You know, we talk about so many things. We laugh, we cry, we argue, we listen, we learn, we engage in a way that doesn't happen when everybody's schedules are going every which way but loose. The family time was such a vital time around the kitchen table, around the dining room table. But one of the things too that was so important is that we prayed. And we have six kids, mom and dad, so each of us had a day to pray. My day to pray was Friday. And so every Friday, I would say grace before the meal. And it was a very simple prayer. I would invite God to bless our food, to bless our family. And very simply put, that was it. But it was a time where we would pause to give God thanks for the bountiful harvest of food that was before us, as well as the family that was able to gather together. And then after our meal was done, we weren't allowed just to leave the table and just leave everything set. You had to be responsible for cleaning up your plate and taking everything into the kitchen. And then those that had the responsibility for helping mom clean up the table afterwards, they would have to remain behind and they would clear the table of all the dinnerware that was left, the food and everything, get that put away, thrown away, whatever needed to be done. And that was an important part of our family because it taught us how to serve. And we learned how to take instruction. We learned how to be responsible for an action that was expected of us being a part of a family. But what else did we do in the dining room? One of the things that I think for my family that the dining room table represented was a place where we sat and we congregated and we would tell stories. I used to love it when my dad's family, his brothers, would come over to visit. We never settled in the living room. We never settled around the TV. We didn't run to go do things. We would all gather in the kitchen dining room area around the dining room table, and we would sit there, and I would sit there, and I would listen to my dad's brothers tell their stories. I learned a lot about my dad's family history. I learned about my dad's brothers when they fought in World War II. My dad's oldest brother and one of his middle brothers. My dad was one of 10 children. And he was one of the younger of the boys, and his two older brothers were in the Army together, and they served in different areas of the Army. But when they went to war against the Germans, they fought in the same area. And my oldest uncle was high on a ridge watching the Germans overtake the valley below where his younger brother was part of that unit that got captured. So my Uncle Jim was, he was a prisoner of war for probably 2 or 3 years. My my guess. And it was during that time, we never really talked about it much, but I did learn during those discussions that he escaped several different times from the prisoner of war camps, only to be captured because he would be caught at a farmhouse stealing eggs and chickens to satisfy his hunger. And it's kind of a laugh moment, but it was very, very serious because he was part of a concentration camp there in Europe as a result of being captured by the Germans. We learned so many other different things. We learned about family tragedy. We learned about things that that normally don't get talked about. Fishing stories my uncles would tell. Some of them pretty unbelievable, but knowing my uncles, probably pretty close to being true. There's so much stuff that happens around a table in the dining room. Did you know that there was a very significant moment in the life of Jesus and his disciples that occurred around a dining room table? It's found in Matthew chapter 26. And in verse 20, it says, when evening came, Jesus was reclining at the table with the 12. You see, Jesus had a table of preparation right before he was to be captured and before his death. And it was at this table that we find out that Judas was going to betray him. And it was at this table that the disciples argued about who was greater than the other. It was at this same table that Jesus introduced the legacy of communion, which was to be followed after he was gone. You see, he passed on at this table a tradition of remembrance. So when we gather together to receive communion, typically we gather around a table where we have the communion elements on. And these communion elements represent a time of remembrance. The Bible says that we are to remember Jesus as we partake of these elements. I love what N.T. Wright, who was a New Testament scholar, wrote. He captured something of the sentiment when he wrote that when Jesus himself wanted to explain to his disciples what his forthcoming death was all about, he didn't give them a theory, he gave them a meal. There's so much that happens over a meal. So much happens when food is served. So what's for dinner? What's for dinner? You know, we spend our whole lives trying to satisfy our appetites, both physically, emotionally, mentally, spiritually. We are looking for ways to fill an inner void. We are looking for ways to fill that emptiness with a need or a desire. We are looking to find ways to fill our lives. And the problem is we fill it with clutter and we fill it with junk food. You see, part of the problem sometimes with our dining room table, it becomes a catch-all. It becomes a catch-all of our everyday busyness. We throw our keys and our billfolds and lay our purses. We put papers down. And sometimes the dining room table gets so cluttered, we can't use it as a gathering place. But now we have to go eat someplace else, in the living room or in the den, in our bedrooms, wherever the ease of being able to have a meal would happen. And we do the same thing in our own lives. We fill our lives full of clutter and junk food. We find the easiest way to satisfy a need, only to find out that it leaves us even hungrier and emptier and wanting more. Bruce Springsteen said, everybody's got a hunger. Everyone's got a hungry heart. So we all have a desire or a drive to find satisfaction of our appetites. I want to talk about spiritual appetites for a moment here. And in Matthew 5, 6, we're reminded when Jesus gave the lesson in the Beatitudes, he said this, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled." Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. It's trying to satisfy our appetites with the right things. James Merritt said there is a spiritual hunger in the human heart and an eternal hunger in the human soul that can never be satisfied with anything other than Jesus Christ, the bread of life. So in all of our longings and yearnings to fill that hunger and that thirst, we have to make sure we are pursuing and eating and nourishing on the right foods. You see, if we're going to remodel the dining room kitchen area, then we must also change what we serve within that environment. Joni Erickson Tada said this, "To hunger is to be human, but to hunger for God is to feed on Him. Hunger and thirst after His righteousness, and feed on Him in your heart. Taste and see that the Lord is good. It is He who will fill you to satisfaction." You see, we have an urge, a desire, an appetite that I would call of the flesh. And it's found in 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17. And it reminds us of the struggle that we have in regard to what we're filling our life with and what we're pursuing to fill our life with. John wrote this. He said, "Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, love for the Father is not in them. For everything in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, comes not from the Father, but from the world. The world and its desires pass away, but whoever does the will of God lives forever." There's an appetite there. And when I get hungry, what am I gonna feast on? When I get hungry, what am I gonna snack on? When I get hungry, what am I gonna prepare to eat? John Piper said, "The greatest enemy of hunger for God is not poison, but apple pie. It is not the banquet of the wicked that dulls our appetite for heaven, but endless nibbling at the table of the world. It is not the X-rated video, but the prime time dribble of triviality we drink in every night." So what he is saying is, when we look at appetite, sometimes we want to look at the worst of the worst. But in actuality, sometimes it's just those simple things that we allow to settle into our lives that fill us up with just emptiness and leave a void, even though there seems to be some semblance of satisfaction that only lasts a moment. Galatians 5 speaks of this. When Paul wrote in verses 16 through 25, Paul said, "So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh," or the appetite of the flesh. "For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. For the acts of the flesh are obvious." These are some of the appetites that Paul mentions. Sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. Paul said this. He said, "I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God." In other words, you're filling yourself up with the wrong stuff. You're eating the wrong foods. You're eating at the wrong table. But verse 22 says, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control." Nine of them. love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. And he says, against such there is no law. Those who belong to Christ have crucified the flesh and with its passions and desires. In other words, you've controlled your appetite to feast on the good things and to avoid the junk food. Since we live by the Spirit, he concludes, let us keep in step with the Spirit. So what was he saying? He was saying what we feed ourselves is important. What we feast at the dining room table on is important. If we feed ourselves junk food, our bodies will be malnourished. We cannot neglect the healthy eating that God is calling us to. How many of you love cookies and ice cream and marshmallows and candy and chips and all those things? And, you know, we've been talking about different diets, keto diet, which is high protein, low or no carbs. You know, we're getting very technical in our diets nowadays in order to strive towards optimum health. Well, why can't we do the same thing spiritually? You see, there's two areas in which the believer is categorized in the types of nourishment that they receive. And the first one is milk. Peter wrote in 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 2 to 3, he says, like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk so that by it you may grow up in your salvation, now that you have tasted that the Lord is good. You have a baby, you're not going to try to feed that baby whole foods. You're not going to try to get that baby to eat anything that it is unable to digest and that is not good for it. You're going to give that baby the best nourishment that you can, and that's found in a mother's breast milk. Well, as a believer, the Bible says that we must learn how to feast on the milk of the Word of God. And that is where we get our beginning. That is where we get our start. And then the second area of our spiritual development is to move from the milk into solid food. And in Hebrews chapter 5, the people were struggling with that. And the writer of Hebrews kind of chides or admonishes them because they're more content to stay on spiritual milk than they are to move into the area of solid food. Verse 12 of Hebrews chapter 5, the writer says, in fact, though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's word all over again. You need milk, not solid food. Anyone who lives on milk, being still an infant, is not acquainted with the teachings about righteousness. So what the writer is saying is you're not ready to move on where you should have been. You should have been on solid food now. But because of your desire to stay on spiritual milk, you have remained an infant in regard to your spiritual maturity. And this is what he says. Verse 14, he says, but solid food is for the mature, who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. So as a believer, when we come to the table of God, when we sit at the dining room table, we have a choice. We either have spiritual milk or we have the spiritual solid food. You make that choice as to where you're going to move your spiritual appetite. Are you going to stay on milk and remain an infant, or are you going to begin to wean yourself from the spiritual milk onto spiritual solid food? You know, one thing I laugh about when I think about food and in regard to this is that I truly believe that food is one of God's love languages. I truly believe that God loves to serve his people food. What are churches and church people known for? Aren't they known for their potlucks? You know, the people just go all out when it comes to a church potluck. They bring their best recipes. They bring their best foods. And let me tell you what, I have had some of my best meals, not at a high-class restaurant, or a favorite fast food joint. I've had my best food. I've had my best meals at a church potluck. I love church potlucks. In fact, when we would do potlucks at the church early on in our ministry here, we do them once a month. We would get more people to show up for a meal than for a sermon. It used to drive me crazy. I would get so frustrated when I would see, you know, almost 100 people at the church potluck, but only 50 or 60 at the church service in the morning. It was just one of those things where I would just have to just grin and bear it, but thankful that people would show up. You know, for many people, what does this say? Many people would come to your dining room table before they would come to church. Do you realize that? That there are people that would come to your dining room table before they would come to church. That's important for you to realize. Because what that says is your dining room can be a place where people can come to know Jesus without really going to church. Your dining room could be a place where people can feel loved and accepted and welcomed before they ever set foot in the place where God has called us to gather. Think about that. I think that's important for us to realize, is that dining room. When God wants to remodel our dining room, He wants to remodel our perspective of the importance of what that dining room table holds for reaching other people for Christ. In Acts chapter 2, verses 46 to 47, it says, every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes, and they ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God, enjoying the favor of all the people. And what happened? And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. So they would meet at the temple courts, and then they'd move from there to people's homes. And then it was there at people's homes, they would break bread, they would talk, and they would share. And the topic of conversation would lead to God, and God would do a life change in people's hearts and lives, adding daily to the number people who were being saved. I just have a final thought for you this morning as I come to a close in regard to the idea of the dynamic of a dining room. I want to talk about a perspective of a story that I think reflects what the dining room represents. But it took place around a campfire. Follow me here if you would, please. Very last chapter of the book of John. The disciples are devastated. They're lost. They're trying to figure things out. Peter has denied Christ 3 times. He's left the ministry, so to speak, and he's gone back to fishing. So all these guys have regathered themselves. They're in a fishing boat. They went out at night and they got skunked. They didn't catch a single fish. As they're coming back towards shore, Jesus is on the shore and he's got a campfire going. And they could smell the coals that were burning. And as they looked and they were trying to figure out who it was, Jesus told them, take your net and throw it out over on the right side of the boat. And when they did that, they ended up catching 153 large fish. I have no idea how many small fish they caught. But the Bible says very specifically, they caught 153 large fish. And it was that moment that they recognized that was Jesus on the shore. Verse 19, John chapter 21, verse 9 through 12. It says, when they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals there with fish on it and some bread. And Jesus said to them, he said, bring some of the fish you have just caught. So Simon Peter climbed back into the boat and he dragged the net ashore. It was so full of large fish, 153. But even with so many, the net was not torn. And Jesus said to them, come and have breakfast. Come and have breakfast. You know, one of the major meals that we think of when we think of the dining room table is the dinner or supper, wherever you're raised, Midwest, East Coast. For us, it was always supper. And so when we gather for breakfast, it's usually less formal. It's usually more of a setting where there people just kind of come and go and that kind of a thing. But I love this setting because what Jesus did around the meal was he began to restore Peter back into ministry. When I was a kid growing up, and I basically had walked away from the church at 13, 14 years old. I came back to the Lord at 17. And when I did, I had some of my most monumental, life-changing conversations with my mom. I found out things about myself that I never knew. Things about my mom and her faith, things about how she was raised and how she grew up. And a lot of times the dinner table was too busy, too chaotic, too noisy. The conversations were more general. But when I would sit at the table with my mom eating breakfast, and it was just her and I, those conversations around that dining room table, not necessarily a campfire, but that dining room table having breakfast became more intimate. And it became opportunities for my mom and I to bond in deeper and ways that we never could have had at the dinner table at 5 o'clock dinner. So I'm so thankful for the idea of what the dining room represented in my life. I have so many great memories. I have so many great memories of my own boys and my own family that we try to establish around the dinner table, family gatherings and family traditions, so to speak, during the holidays and so on and so forth. But the thing that I love most is that the conversations that happen around that dinner table can bring life and life more abundantly into people's lives, yours and mine too. As we close this morning, I want to remind you that we have a network of a prayer team that would love to pray with you. If you're experiencing difficulty in your life and you would like prayer, feel free to text to that same number that you text connection into, and just text the word prayer. And if you'd give us a little bit of detail as to what we can pray for you about, that'd be great. Otherwise, just text prayer and we'll just know to pray for you. No details given. God knows, and we'll lift that up before him. But if you would like to receive prayer this week, we would love to pray with you and for you. Next week, as we continue on with the idea of remodel and rooms in which we are remodeling, living room last week, dining room this week, next week it's going to be talking about the bathroom and doing a bathroom remodel and how the bathroom represents a place of preparation and how important that is in our faith journey, that we are living a life of preparation. God bless you. Have a great week in Him. And again, if you haven't done so already, if you want to join our 21 Days of Hope engagement, please text the word HOPE and come on board with us, and we're going to have a fun ride over these next 21 days. God bless you. Have a great week in Him.
gift of love could I offer to a king? What weight or worth could be held within my offering? When he alone is worthy, a glory song is inscribed upon my heart. This treasure held in an alabaster jar, I break to bring him all the glory. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. What sacrifice could be equal to his own? The cross of Christ has declared that there is naught I owe.